Hello, my dear friends. Our topic for presentation today is duodenal atresia, stenosis, and annular pancreas. Duodenal atresia is one of the most common site of neonatal intestinal obstruction. Earlier, mortality of duodenal atresia was high, according to a case series reported in 1931. In around 250 reported cases of duodenal atresia, only 9 of the patients survived. Times have changed. Now the survival rate has come up to 95%. Duodenal atresia has an association with Down syndrome. And in earlier period, when the patient had Down syndrome, the patient was left untreated in case of duodenal atresia. And the patient and the child was left to die. But as time progressed, the medical ethics has progressed. And a universal operative approach is the norm today. So, in case of duodenal atresia, a universal operative approach is considered. Now, coming to the embryology of duodenal atresia. In third week, gastrulation occurs. We can see here that in gastrulation, the three layers of embryo are formed. Area facing the amnion forms the ectoderm, and the area facing the yolk sac forms the endoderm, and in between it becomes the mesoderm. The endoderm by fourth week of gestation becomes the gut tube. We can see the endoderm turning into the gut tube slowly here. Here we can see the formation of the gut tube here. Once the gut tube is formed, by around sixth week of gestation, the gut epithelium proliferates. Suppose this is the gut and this is the epithelium here. It proliferates and fills the lumen. After that, what happens is recanalization. After proliferation and filling of the lumen, recanalization occurs. Recanalization of the lumen occurs. Duodenal atresia is a defect in the recanalization. If some of the cells persist here, some of the proliferated cells, it becomes a web. A duodenal web. Duodenal atresia is due to errors in recanalization during the sixth week or after the sixth week of gestation, during the early part of gestation. Whereas in other parts of bowel, like jejunal atresia and ileal atresia, are due to vascular accidents and they occur during the later phase of gestation. Coming to the association of duodenal atresia with other congenital anomalies. Duodenal atresia has a high association with Down syndrome or trisomy 21. It is also associated with duodenal atresia, is also associated with annular pancreas, and annular pancreas per se can be a cause of duodenal obstruction. Then congenital heart disease. Many a times the cause for death of a child after duodenal atresia is congenital heart disease, and the malrotation can be also associated with duodenal atresia. These are the congenital associations of duodenal atresia. Now coming to the duodenal obstruction per se. Duodenal obstruction can be either intrinsic or extrinsic, or it can be a complete or a partial obstruction. If an intrinsic obstruction is an obstruction inside the lumen of the duodenum. Some problem with the duodenum per se. An extrinsic obstruction is some other outside structures, some other development of other structures are causing the obstruction of duodenum, like annular pancreas, Lattice band, etc. We'll come to it. The obstruction of duodenum is generally complete in 81% of the patients and partial in 19% of the patients. And generally, complete obstruction presents early and partial obstructions presents late. Coming to the extrinsic obstruction of duodenum, the causes are annular pancreas, a pre-duodenal portal vein, and Lattice band and volvulus. How does annular pancreas form? Normally, we can see a dorsal bud and ventral bud of the pancreas. The ventral bud rotates like this posteriorly. Ventral bud rotates posteriorly and comes posteriorly, and the ventral bud and the dorsal bud fuses to form the normal pancreas. But what happens in annular pancreas? In annular pancreas, what happens is, instead of going completely from here to here in annular pancreas is some part of the duodenum. Its duodenum get dragged like that. Only some part of the duodenum gets migrated into the dorsal surface, and this results in the formation of a ring of or annulus of pancreas around the duodenum, causing a complete or a partial duodenal obstruction. So this is the classical picture of annular pancreas causing a annulus around the duodenum, causing complete or a partial obstruction of the duodenum. Now coming to the development of the pre-duodenal portal vein. How does a pre-duodenal portal vein obstructs the duodenum? We can see the development of the venous system in the fetus. We can see a liver development of the liver and both the vitelline veins and the veins connecting the vitelline veins. So normally, so this is the endodermal gut tube. The yellow thing is the endodermal gut tube, and these are the vitelline veins, and this is the developing liver. So what happens is, normally the portal vein should develop like this. These parts of the vitelline tube should disappear, and the portal vein should up. These parts should disappear, and the portal vein should come like this. The posterior part of the duodenum. This is the appearance of the normal portal vein. This is the appearance of the normal portal vein passing posterior to the duodenum. But what happens in case of a anomalous pre-duodenal portal vein? You can see that instead of this part disappearing, it forms the main part of the portal vein, forming a pre-duodenal portal vein obstructing the duodenum. Its cause is lats band or malrotation. We can see this is a normal fixation of the bowel, where we can see cecum in the right lower quadrant, fixation of cecum and the right lower quadrant, the fixation of the ascending colon, and then the fixation of the small bowel in this fashion from extending from the right iliac fossa towards the duodenum, and the fixation of the duodenum near the ligament of Treats. So it is some kind of an inverted N-shaped pattern. So what happens if the cecum has not descended? You see, the cecum will come and lie near the duodenum. It causes two things. One is cecum is trying to get fixated towards the lateral wall of the abdomen. So this incomplete fixations of the cecum towards the lateral wall of the abdomen can result in this lats band, which connects the duodenum and the cecum and the lateral wall of the abdomen. So this bands crossing over the duodenum is called a lat band, which can cause obstruction. Another thing which happens during this period is that due to the close lie bit of the duodenum and the cecum, the attachment of the small bowel mesentery is only this. It was supposed to be like this, extending from the right upper quadrant to the duodenum here. So, but in case of malrotation, what happens is the small bowel mesentery is only this much. So, a large amount of small bowel is hanging around a thin mesenteric root. So, there is a high chance of volvulus. So, in these patients, where we can see a lats band here, when we move the small bowel along with the lats band, there can be a malrotation in patients coming with bilious vomiting. So this is what is happening in malrotation, lats band and volvulus. So all these can coexist: a malrotation here, a lats band here, and along with lats band there can also be a volvulus. So, incomplete fixation of the bowel can, or abnormalities in fixation of bowel can result in lats band, malrotation and volvulus. So, these are all causes of extrinsic obstruction of the duodenum. That is annular pancreas, pre-duodenal portal vein, lats band, malrotation and volvulus. Now coming to the different types of intrinsic duodenal obstruction. There are type 1, type 2, and type 1, type 2, and type 3 in case of intrinsic duodenal obstruction. In the intrinsic duodenal obstruction, the obstruction is in the lumen of the duodenum. In case of type 1 obstruction, this is the type 1 obstruction, what happens is there is no discontinuity in the bowel or in the mesentery of the duodenum. The duodenum from outside appears continuous, but inside the duodenum there will be a web like this. Inside the duodenum there can be a web like this. There can be a web, the web is appearing like this. There can be a, we expect, when we initially learned, we expect the web to be like this. It is generally not like that. The web can hang on distally like this. So that is called a windsock deformity. That means even though the position of the web is proximal, even though the position of the web is here proximal, the obstruction, you can see the position of the web here is proximal, but the obstruction outside will appear like this, appear to be at this side due to the bulging of the web like this. The amount of bulging of the web can be different in different people and different in neonates, and it can extend a long way, causing a windsock deformity in upper gastrointestinal studies. So this is a picture of a windsock. So no mesenteric discontinuity, no bowel discontinuity, but a web in type 1 duodenal atresia. This classification was by Gross and Scanlakis. Now, in type 2 duodenal atresia, the proximal duodenum is distended and there is a distal jejunum, but the area in between is connected by a fibrous band. The area in between is, there is no bowel continuity in between. The area is in between is connected by a fibrous band. In type 3 cases, there is mesenteric discontinuity and bowel discontinuity in type 3 duodenal obstruction. So these are the different types of intrinsic duodenal obstruction: type 1, type 2, and type 3. How does this duodenal obstruction presents? It can present antenatally as maternal polyhydramnios. This is the classical double bubble appearance. The classical double bubble appearance of duodenal obstruction in a abdominal x-ray of the neonate. This appearance can also be seen in prenatal ultrasonography. The patient clinically presents, once the child is born, the child presents as repeated bilious emesis. The amount of vomiting, the symptoms of the patient will depend upon whether the obstruction is partial or a complete obstruction. The classical double bubble appearance is seen in duodenal atresia, and classically, and the abdomen of the patient is not distended because there is no gas in the distal bubble. The obstruction can be either a partial obstruction or a complete obstruction depending upon whether there is a hole in the web or not. Coming to the diagnosis of obstruction, a classical double bubble appearance will help in the diagnosis of duodenal atresia, and we can proceed to treatment like duodenostomy. But if there is no classical double bubble appearance, but the stomach and the duodenum is distended and there is distal gas, we are not sure whether it is a duodenal atresia. It can be a lats band, it can be a malrotation, it can be anything. So the crucial point in case of this duodenal obstruction and bilious vomiting is that we have to distinguish whether it is a volvulus or just a duodenal atresia. If there is no classical picture of double bubble appearance, there is a doubt. So what we have to do? If there is a volvulus, a large amount of intestine will be going in for gangrene. We know that in case of malrotation, the pedicle of the superior mesenteric artery is thin and the whole of the intestine is hanging on that pedicle. Once there is volvulus, all the intestine is going to be gangrenous, and which result in a resection of all this bowel and result in a short bowel syndrome, and the child is going to die, or there will be failure to thrive in case of child. So If it is a malrotation and volvulus, the approach to it is very emergent. We have to go for a laparotomy as early as possible. But if it is a duodenal atresia, it's a classical duodenal atresia, it will buy us some time in order to rule out other congenital defects. Now, suppose we are seeing a partial obstruction, or if there is a distal gas, or if there is no classical double bubble appearance, what will we do? We have to go for upper barium studies or upper GI series of the barium swallow. In case of barium swallow, how will we distinguish between whether it is a malrotation with volvulus or a duodenal atresia? In case of duodenal atresia, the obstruction is generally in the second part of the duodenum. You know, the first part of duodenum, second part of duodenum, third part and the fourth part of duodenum. In case of duodenal atresia, the obstruction is in the second part, and we can see the contour of the duodenum is like this. There is a blunt contour of the duodenum. It can be due to the ballooning of the web. But in case of a malrotation or an extrinsic obstruction, a malrotation with volvulus or an extrinsic obstruction, there can be two features. We have to look for these two features. One is the beaking. One is the beaking of the duodenum, and it generally is seen in the third part of duodenum. The first part, second part, and it is in the third part of duodenum. A bird beaking appearance of the duodenum is seen. And another feature is a corkscrew appearance of the duodenum, which is also a feature of a corkscrew appearance of the bowel, which is also a feature of the volvulus of the malrotation with volvulus. That is regarding the diagnosis of duodenal obstruction. Now coming to the, once we have diagnosed it as duodenal atresia, the treatment is preoperatively we have to go for a blood investigation and decide on the emergency of surgery depending upon the abdominal x-ray and barium studies, and decide whether immediate emergency surgery is required or not. Then if there is time to rule out other congenital anomalies, we know that there is association between cardiac disease and duodenum and Down syndrome, etc., and duodenal atresia. If there is time, we have to rule out other congenital anomalies. We have to put in a nasogastric aspirate for the we have to go for a nasogastric aspiration for the child, and we have to also put in, if possible, a peripherally inserted central line for postoperative parenteral nutrition of the child. Next is, what is the treatment in case of duodenal atresia? The standard classical treatment and the safest treatment is duodenostomy. Two in type of incision can be used. One is a periumbilical incision like that used, but normally the incision preferred is in between the liver edge and the umbilicus. In between the upper right upper quadrant incision is generally preferred. This is the right upper quadrant incision is generally preferred for approach of the duodenum. Once we have opened the abdomen by laparotomy, first step in order to approach the duodenum, first step is mobilization. Mobilization is by mobilizing the hepatic flexure of the colon and mobilizing it downwards and pulling it downwards. Next, we have to go for the cauterization of the duodenum. Cauterization of the duodenum, we have to mobilize the duodenum here. While cauterization of the duodenum, we have to see that we do not injure the bile duct. We can mobilize the duodenum up to the third or fourth part of the duodenum, up to the ligament of Treitz, if the anatomy is deemed necessary like that, or if the obstruction is more distal. Now, rule out a proximal web, a transpyloric tube can be passed. Once that is confirmed, the next step is we have to go for an incision in the proximal and distal to the obstruction. Suppose this is the obstruction, we have to put the incision here and the incision here. See the type of incision there. Normally in bowel, we can do a simple anastomosis like that in proximal and distal. But this technique of diamond shaped anastomosis technique by Kimura, the incision is put in a smiling incision is put in the closer to part of the stomach proximal part of duodenum, and a vertical incision is put in the distal part of the duodenum. Once an incision is put before the anastomosis, what we have to do is we have to pass a Foley's catheter proximal through the proximal incision towards the stomach to rule out any proximal webs, and we have to also pass this Foley's catheter distally through the duodenum through the distal incision to rule out any other web or a Winsock anomaly, and we have to pull back the Foley with the inflated bulb in order to rupture any small web if it is present. Once we have made sure that the duodenum is free of any of obstruction from stomach to the fourth part of duodenum is free, now we have to rule out any other atresias in the jejunum and ileum. To make sure that, we have to use a syringe and we have to push fluid through the jejunum, through the opening of the duodenum into the jejunum. We can see the filling of the jejunum by the fluid. And once we have made sure that the jejunum is filling with fluid, we can confirm that there is no other distal obstruction in case of in the particular case of duodenal atresia. After that, we can go for an anastomosis. The anastomosis is done like this, so that the proximal gastric incision, when opened, will appear like this, and when the proximal duodenal incision will appear like this, and the distal incision, when separated, will be like this. After that, we take sutures from here and from here and from here and from this part to this part, and first a proximal layer is put, and then a distal layer is put, and finally a diamond shaped anastomosis is we acquire a diamond shaped anastomosis, so that there is enough opening for the passage of food. This type of anastomosis by Kimura is found to be superior to simple anastomosis in bringing the postoperative gastric and duodenal function. Now, coming to the postoperative management, can be by parenteral feeds. Enteral feeding is generally delayed. If a transanastomotic tube is put, some people prefer a transanastomotic tube. Another set of surgeons doesn't prefer transanastomotic tube. Transanastomotic tube has its own advantage of early enteral feeding, but a disadvantage of misplacement and intestinal injuries. So, transanastomotic tube is a controversial. So, if there is a transanastomotic tube, early enteral feeding can be start. And when to start enteral feeds, that will depend upon the nasogastric aspirate. We have to look at the nasogastric aspirate, and we have to see whether the color of the nasogastric aspirate changes from the green to the light yellow colors. If the color of the nasogastric aspirate become lighter and becomes the nasogastric aspirate quantity is also decreasing, we can slowly start enteral feeding. Enteral feeding can be by breastfeeds or formula feeds. Now, that we have discussed about the open approach, then another approach is a laparoscopic approach. This is the classical port position. If the child is less than 2 kg, laparoscopic approach is less preferred because there is inadequate space in many cases. The duodenum is here. We put the ports like this in the umbilical port for camera, and another two ports for, and this is a triangulation. We are getting the triangulation with the umbilical port and the camera with the laparoscopic technique. So these are the port positions here. These are the port positions, and an additional port can be put here in the epigastrium or lateral towards this port in order to retract the liver. So once these ports are placed, we have to, after retracting the liver, we have to identify the duodenum. Once duodenum is identified, we can hitch the duodenum towards the anterior abdominal wall with the help of a blood jet in the surface of the abdomen in order to prevent any mark of the sutures on the anterior abdominal wall. And once the duodenum is located, we can put incision, and after confirming the distal and proximal patency of the bowel, we can go for an anastomosis of the anastomosis, that is duodenostomy. That is regarding the laparoscopic approach. There are other surgical methods. When to use this? Generally, if possible, duodenostomy is the best preferred surgical method. If it is an annular pancreas, In no way you should touch the pancreas. Only surgical method preferred is duodenoduodenostomy. But suppose it is only a web. Some people can do a duodenotomy and see the web and do a partial excision of the web, preserving the ampulla of the Waiter. Sometimes the ampulla of Waiter can open into the distal duct can be running through the surface of the web. So we have to identify the ampulla of Waiter, and if at all we are doing a partial excision of the web, we have to make sure we have to identify the ampulla of the Waiter and then only do the excision. But duodenoduodenostomy is considered superior to it. Another method, if in the duodenum, in case of development and anomaly of the duodenum, like duodenal atresia, on not only the anatomic, not only there is the anatomical problem, there is also a functional component, and this functional component will result in the dilatation of the proximal part of the duodenum, and this proximal attorney of the duodenum can result in postoperative obstruction even if an anastomosis is performed. So in that case, we can consider a tapering of the duodenum like this. We can consider a tape. An incision is put on the anterior surface of the duodenum. The ampulla of the Waiter is identified, and we can cut a portion of the duodenum like this, cut a portion of the duodenum like this, and remove it, making sure that the bile duct and the pancreatic duct is not injured, and we can resuture the rest of the portion of the duodenum over a dilator, and the duodenum can be tapered in order to prevent the postoperative attorney of the duodenum. Then another method, which was earlier practiced also, is duodenojejunostomy. If the ana this is duodenojejunostomy is considered if the anatomy of the child is difficult in order for to perform a duodenojejunostomy. The results of duodenojejunostomy is comparable to that of duodenoduodenostomy. The jejunum is brought in a retrocolic fashion posterior to the transverse colon and to do a duodenojejunostomy. In some cases, the duodenal atresic part of the duodenum is towards the ligament of Treitz, and in that case, there is a grossly dilated segment of the duodenum, the long part of duodenum that is dilated. So even if there is an anastomosis performed in the duodenum, it is not going to hold because the obstruction is distal to it. In that case, a duodenojejunostomy is performed like a patch repair of a patch duodenojejunostomy is performed like this, where the dilated part of the duodenum is the dilated part of the duodenum is excised, and the jejunum is patulated like this. Jejunum is patulated like this, and ampulla of Waiter is identified, and a duodenojejunostomy is performed, preserving the biliary and pancreatic duct. These are the other surgical methods which comes in relation with the duodenal atresia. Now comes the complications after surgery. One is incorrect identification of site. This is because of the windsock deformity. We know that. Suppose this is a bowel and this is a duodenum, and suppose the obstruction is web is like that, and the web is extending like this to here, and the obstruction will appear to be here because the bowel will be dilated until there. So what happens if we are going to do an anastomosis between here and here? What will happen? The obstruction is proximal to the anastomosis, and this can happen if the surgeon is not careful and he is not passing the Holis tube proximally and distally to rule out any other webs. Then there can be, in rare cases, there can be more than one obstruction. We should not be happy with only we have passed a tube proximally and we have found a web. We should not be happy with only that. We should also pass distally, and we should also make sure that there is no obstruction in the jejunum and ileum. Postoperatively, the complications can also not only occur preoperative during peroperatively, it can occur postoperatively. There is prolonged feeding intolerance in some patients due to the attorney or the functional problem with the duodenum, the functional defect in the duodenum, and there can in some cases when web, a partial web excision is only done, an impacted foot material, impacted fibrous foot material can block that partially corrected web. And in some cases, along with the growth of the child, the anastomosis is not also increasing inside, which results in stricture. And in case of atony, we have to go for a tapering of the duodenum. In case of a stricture, we may have to consider a duodenojejunostomy. Now, outcomes in the survival of the patient with duodenostomy, with duodenal atresia, has increased up to 95%. It was in 9 out of 250 in the early 1940s. Now 1914s, and it has come to 95% survival at present. And mortality in case of duodenal atresia is generally due to other causes and not due to the problem with the anastomosis, with cardiac anomalies and other causes along with Down syndrome, and not due to the problem with the anastomosis or any technical defects. So as far as we are concerned, duodenal atresia has to be properly identified, and it is a correctable anomaly, and we have to make sure that we should not miss a malrotation when we are approaching a bilious vomiting. In brief, we have discussed about the embryology, the clinical features of duodenal atresia, clinical presentation of duodenal atresia, the workup of duodenal atresia, the open and laparoscopic managements of duodenal atresia, the other surgical procedures which we can do in duodenal atresia. And with that, let me conclude, my dear friends. Thank you.